our Lord and Savior this morning. Hallelujah. Yeah. It's so good to be in the house of the Lord. Yeah. All right, let's sing together. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Here we go.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunders and leaves us breathless? This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That
a new one for you this morning, so you all just join in as you feel led. Let's get those hands clapping right here. Yeah. Abby's gonna lead us on this one.
God, I'm on my knees again. God, I'm begging, please again. I need you. Oh, I need you. walking down these desert roads. Water for my thirsty soul. I need you. Oh, I need you. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. Like the sound of a symphony to my ears. Like holy water on my skin. Dead man walking, slave to sin. I wanna know about being born again. I need you. Oh God, I need you. So take me to the riverside, take me under, baptize. I need you. Oh God, I need you. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my head, like the sound of a symphony in my ears, like holy.
Your grace, God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. Y'all sing it now.
I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change.
Sing it out.
I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me wanna change. I don't wanna abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me wanna change. Your forgiveness. Oh, it's like sweet, sweet honey on my.
My God is mighty to save.
Wanted to stone her,
the adulterous woman,
for her sin. They found out about it
and wanted to punish,
act harshly with
extreme prejudice, act in the name of God,
or so they thought,
for God was nowhere near,
or so they thought.
They cornered her. Death on their minds.
To teach a lesson. She'd been caught. Now was the time for real
justice.
In the name of God.
Ironically,
God spoke.
Go ahead and throw your death. Give it your best shot.
But,
before you do, let the one without sin throw first.
Hello?
Nothing. Silence.
Embarrassment. Backs turned. Eyes averted. For today, anyway.
The woman, caught, now given freedom.
Go and sin no more,
God spoke.
Are we afraid?
To be that woman?
Because sometimes we're afraid the angry crowd
won't be turned away.
Despite
what God says. Afraid that stones would fly.
Right past his head.
Past his head.
Past his words.
And find their mark. But what if
getting caught
wasn't a bad thing?
That the stones would drop.
Maybe never even gathered.
That his words
and his people
would be one.
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 One. One.
I wonder if the woman had seen the stones before.
And tried to hide.
An actress born out of necessity.
There are no stones if you don't tell.
Or are careful enough.
Acting is better than dealing with deaf ears stuffed with judgments.
If I act like them, I don't disappoint anyone, and no one will know. Never thinking she could tell.
Anyone.
Too many stones around.
Not enough open hands.
Hearts.
To be real with.
To trust.
If I can fake it, why share it? We can be so quick.
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 Quick to take the adulterous woman to be stoned.
Instead.
Real.
Being real.
Being real about the darkness.
Each other's.
And especially our own.
Shining light on it.
Beating the stones together.
To create.
A new spark.
A new spark.
A new spark of
light.
If I were to ask you what you thought was absolutely necessary for life, what would you say? You might think about what we talked about last Sunday, having daily bread, because food is indispensable for life, right? Well, what if I were to say that what we're going to be talking about today also is essential for a life that's fulfilled, content, godly? As we continue in our series on the Lord's Prayer, we're going to consider today how forgiveness is imperative for the kind of life God wants for any of us who are in imperfect relationships, and that includes all of us. So if you thought you might catch a snooze today, because this part of the Lord's Prayer doesn't really apply to you, Forgiveness is not a luxury. It is something crucial for life. Jesus knew what he was talking about when he placed the need for forgiveness right alongside the need for daily bread. What one is in terms of the ongoing needs of the body, the other is in terms of the ongoing needs of the human spirit and human relationships. From the jump, let's be clear. Forgiveness is needed by everyone because everyone sins. Romans 3:23. For everyone has sinned. We all fall short of God's glorious standard. Every one of us is imperfect and has sinned. Forgiveness is an important dimension in our everyday lives, because the reality is, every day, every one of us is imperfect. We make mistakes. We make wrong choices. We fail. Every day, each one of us falls short and lives a less than ideal life. We're not perfect. We do not always live in ways that meet God's standard. Every morning that each of us wakes up, we can be pretty sure of a couple of things. One is that we will experience physical hunger. And the other is we or someone we know will mess up and forgiveness will be needed if our relationships with God and others are to be healthy and holy. Whether we forgive and how we forgive are critical in the face of sins, because our sins have far-reaching consequences. The foods we choose to eat have far-reaching consequences for our physical health. If we take in food that's poisonous to our bodies, the consequences are major, life-threatening. If we choose to be unforgiving, if we fail to be forgiving, that can be emotionally and spiritually poisonous to us, and the consequences can be majorly life-threatening in their own way. So let's consider several ways to deal with sin, failure, imperfection in human life. One way of dealing with these things is unconcerned underreaction, discounting its importance or denying its significance. Now, this response is chosen over and over again in the face of sin and human failing. In fact, among many people, it has become the norm. They're like, it's no big deal. Everyone does it. Everybody sins. It is nothing to get all worked up about. You don't need to worry about it. It's just the way that life is and people are. The whole idea of sin and its destructive consequences are pretty much ignored or not taken seriously. It's kind of like the idea, no hurt, no foul. But when sin takes place, hurt does happen, no matter how much anyone may try and deny it. If there was no hurt, why would forgiveness be needed? How did it come to be in our culture that sin and its destructive power are more and more considered unimportant and insignificant? For many, it's because they no longer believe in moral absolutes. They say everything is relative. They believe what might be wrong for one person could be all right for another person. They hold that moral judgments are simply a matter of personal opinion or cultural conditioning. This belief leads to the conclusion that no one should really feel guilty for much of anything, because after all, who gets to decide what's right and what's wrong? Many people think that human sin, failure, or imperfection is really not a reason for concern, because they buy into a belief in determinism. When someone does something wrong, their attitude is, well, he couldn't help it, or she couldn't help it, as if they had no control over the choices they made. It's accepting the condition that we're not really responsible for our actions because it was beyond our control, or it's to be blamed or someone or something outside of ourselves. It's because of the way I was raised. It was because of the way he treated me or the way she treated me. I just couldn't help myself. Think with me for a moment. If all values are relative, and if all human actions are determined, there's no such things as truth or falsehood, goodness or badness, heroism or cowardice. Mother Teresa is no more to be admired than Adolf Hitler condemned. You see, there really are great cause if we do not worry about sin any longer. The result is that meaning is drained out of everything, not just our sins, but also our best efforts. All we're left with is emptiness and futility. One way of dealing with sin, failure, imperfection in human life is unconcerned underreaction, discounting its importance or denying its significance. Another way is destructive overreaction, trying to defeat or destroy it on its own terms. This approach can be summed up this way. If you punch me in the face, I'm going to punch you right back in the face. If you steal from me, I'm going to steal from you. If you lie to me, I'm going to lie to you. If you cheat on me, I'm going to cheat on you. I'll give you a dose of your own medicine. This leads to what is called equivalent injustice. Now, this approach at least takes sin and failure and imperfection seriously. It doesn't try to deny or minimize it. But this approach is also destructive. It's poisonous in its own way. It really doesn't solve the problem. If you put out my eye unjustly, and I put out your eye, the number of eyes destroyed is doubled. And you will likely try to put out my other eye. Responding to sin and failure and imperfection with sin and failure and imperfection is not really helpful. Evil will never truly be defeated by responding with evil. Fire cannot be put out by responding with fire. More water is of no use in rescuing someone who is drowning. So what's the answer? How does God want us to respond to sin, failure, imperfection in human life? A third option is constructive hopefulness, facing up to it without giving up. William Mule shares the story of a 5-year-old boy. This 5-year-old worked all fall on a ceramic gift he wanted to give to his parents for Christmas. On the last day of school before holidays began, and after the traditional Christmas program that his parents had come to watch, the boy was running down the hall and trying to put his coat on and trying to wave goodbye to his classmates all at the same time. In the process, he slipped and fell, and the ceramic gift he had worked so hard on for so long crashed to the floor with a terrible shattering sound. There was a moment of silence. And then when the boy realized what had happened, he broke into uncontrollable sobs. In an effort to comfort him, the father responded, "Don't cry, son. Don't cry. It doesn't really make any difference." The mother responded, "But it does matter. It matters a great deal." And she took the boy in her arms and wept with him. And then after a while, she stooped over and gently said, "Let's pick up the pieces and see what we can make of what's left." That is forgiveness at its best. Not discounting failures or imperfections, and not denying the hurt and heartache that come with them. When someone does that which is wrong and sinful, genuine forgiveness does not say, "Oh, it's okay," when it's not. Genuine forgiveness does not try and let someone off the hook from the consequences of what they've done. Godly forgiveness takes evil seriously, but not ultimately. It dares to see beyond the brokenness of the moment and looks to the something positive that can be made of what is left. Godly forgiveness takes wrong seriously, but remains hopeful even in the face of it. Godly forgiveness doesn't give up on us when we fail. And we are to relate to others in their imperfection in that way too. When Jesus teaches in the Lord's Prayer, "And forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors," Jesus says something that may startle some of us. Jesus says we're to ask God to forgive us the way that we forgive others. Now, as some of us ponder that, we may be taking a big gulp. because we may not be sure that's what we really want. There's a version of the Lord's Prayer many of us are familiar with that speaks about forgiving our trespasses. The Greek word Jesus uses here was ophelima. It's only used twice in the Bible. It has the meaning debt, offense, sin. In John's gospel, Jesus tells the story of a woman caught in sin. The legal experts and Pharisees brought a woman caught in adultery. Placing her in the center of the group, they said to Jesus, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the act of committing adultery. In the law, Moses commanded us to stone women like this. What do you say?" They said this to test him, because they wanted a reason to bring an accusation against him. Jesus bent down and wrote on the ground with his finger. They continued to question him, so he stood up and replied, "Whoever hasn't sinned should throw the first stone." Bending down again, he wrote on the ground. Those who heard him went away, one by one, beginning with the elders. Finally, only Jesus and the woman were left in the middle of the crowd. Jesus stood up and said to her, "Woman, where are they? Is there no one to condemn you?" She said, "No one, sir." Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go, and from now on, don't sin anymore." The woman was obviously in the wrong, as was her male partner, who mysteriously is absent from this scene of accusation. Both the adulterous woman and the adulterous man were in the wrong. And so were the men who condemned her. For their true motive was to use her to try and trap Jesus so that he would be condemned. In the face of such darkness, Jesus might have thrown up his hands in disgust and called down destruction on the whole lot of them. But that was not the approach to failure that Jesus chose. Jesus stooped over and began writing on the ground with his finger. No one knows what he wrote, though it's been suggested he wrote, "Where is the man?" It does take two, you know, for adultery to take place. Or Jesus is writing in the sand may have simply been a way of diverting attention from the woman for a moment as she stood in shame in the center of the group with likely little or no clothes on. This suggests that even in the midst of her sinfulness, Jesus saw her as created in the image of God and as a person who should receive compassion, though she had done wrong. For Jesus, forgiveness is about salvaging rather than scrapping. Jesus doesn't cast us aside when we mess up. Jesus does not relegate us to the scrap heap like junk, out of sight, out of mind. Rather, Jesus wants for us, hopefully, to learn from our mistakes and for new beginnings to be embraced. Jesus speaks these challenging words in the Sermon on the Mount. "For you will be treated as you treat others. The standard you use in judging is the standard by which you will be judged." For legalistic, condemning accusers, this would be bad news, not good news. That would be true back then, and it is true now. When Jesus says, "Whoever hasn't sinned should throw the first stone," he's accusing the accusers. He's challenging them to examine their own motivations and attitudes and actions. Godly forgiveness requires self-confrontation. It requires that we look at our own lives and deal with the darkness there before we go into condemnation mode or before we project our own sinful thoughts and intentions onto others. Let's be clear. Jesus did not reject those who engaged in adultery. Nor did Jesus reject those who wanted to manipulate him. Jesus wants each of us to face up to our own failings before focusing on the failings of others. At the end, no accusers remained. Just the broken woman and Jesus. What happened? With serious hopefulness, Jesus charged her to go and sin no more, believing there are second chances with God. Well, what if you think you just can't do that because you're so discouraged by the failings you've encountered? Understand, forgiveness is about undiscourageable love. This is the good news of the Christian faith. Godly forgiveness faces up to wrongdoing. It does not deny it, but neither does it give up on the people who sin. And that is good news for all of us because that includes all of us. If we're going to live lives that reflect the way of Jesus, we need to embrace across the board that we all are in need of forgiveness, even and especially when we suffer the hurtful consequences of our own sin. We need to remember that in our kind of world, forgiveness is necessary. It is essential because none of us or our relationships are perfect. So, the next time you pray, forgive us as we forgive others, will you mean it? Really, will you mean it?
Jesus, my Jesus, and you. will be.